Now, on this list, there are a number of things in brackets at the bottom, and that's just because these are not essence syndromes, if you will, in themselves. They are usually the underlying causes of some of the problems. So, for instance, children with borderline intellectual functioning in our societies, they have a huge risk of being diagnosed as having ADHD, because it's very difficult in a modern society to be concentrated, to, you know, sit down for like hours on end and work in school. If your IQ, if you talk about it in that sort of term, is in the order of like 75 to 80. And about 10%, 12% of the whole population, in all populations, according to the IQ tests that we use, have borderline intellectual functioning. This is usually never even thought about, or at least not in practical terms, in clinical terms. But it's very, very important for helping children to understand that, of course, it's going to be difficult to, you know, academically achieve and be the right sort of pupil if you are in a big group, no extra support, nothing, no understanding, and you have an IQ of 75. It's all fine and well when you start to talk about IQs under 70, because then in most countries there's some understanding that, oh, we've actually seen that he is, as it were, intellectually disabled, so he needs more help. But the big group with sub-normal, if you will, whatever that is, but I mean low IQ, that's a very difficult clinical problem, and one which is usually not talked about. The behavioral phenotype syndromes include things like fragile X, tuberous sclerosis, 22q11 deletion syndrome, but also fetal alcohol syndrome, valproic acid syndrome, and various syndromes that are caused by toxic agents in utero. And if you take each and every one of them separately, except for fetal alcohol syndrome, which is quite common, all the others are very rare on an individual basis, like fragile X or tuberous sclerosis, very often in the range of 1 in 10,000 children. So people generally think, I don't need to know about that because it's so rare, it's not going to happen to me, or it's not going to happen to one of the kids that I see in my clinic, etc. But together, they're more than 2% of the general population, not of our population that we see in clinics or schools, but in the general population. So 2% of all people, whether young children or young adults, have a behavioral phenotype syndrome. That's a genetic or toxic syndrome that we know the cause of, and that can be categorized very specifically as this is Fragile X syndrome or 22q11 deletion syndrome. And virtually all of them, except for a very small group that like Down syndrome, that's recognized immediately because of the physical characteristics in the majority of the cases. But the vast majority of these cases are not recognized by anything else than one of the other diagnoses on the list: ADHD, language disorder, autism. And then there are all the epilepsy and neuromuscular disorders that present with ADHD, autism, etc. We've just completed a big study in the UK where we've looked first at school-aged children with epilepsy, any kind of epilepsy, and then at preschool children with epilepsy, any kind of epilepsy. And in the school-aged population, 98% have more than epilepsy. They have something on this list. They have ADHD, autism, language disorder, intellectual disability, and not least, developmental coordination disorder. Most children with epilepsy have motor coordination problems, and that's usually not acknowledged at all. The same now holds for the group with cerebral palsy. We're looking, because in the past, cerebral palsy was also considered to be, oh, it's cerebral palsy. It explains everything, as it were. So you can't even mention the fact that he's also intellectually disabled or has autism or ADHD because it's cerebral palsy. But the fact is that the vast majority of children with cerebral palsy have one of these other essence diagnoses or meet criteria, and they should be helped for those problems, not just their cerebral palsy. It also holds for Duchenne muscular dystrophy, you name it, virtually anything that affects the brain and the neuromuscular system, you would have to expect some of the other problems on this list and not just, you know, put a blind eye to it and say, well, it's all because of the Duchenne. It could be that it's all because of the Duchenne, but it doesn't matter that you only have it as a consequence of something, you still need help for it. And we've just now completed a new study that's being published as we speak about febrile seizures. Febrile seizures has been considered for years and years to be, you know, just that, nothing else. And usually it doesn't lead on to epilepsy, and usually it doesn't lead on to more brain damage. It's a harrowing thing to you know, experience as a parent the first time. But you provide, as a doctor, if they come to the clinic, you provide, you know, just calm them down and you know, say some things about it's not going to be a problem in the long run, etc. And it's true from the point of view of more general, very severe problems, except 15% will develop epilepsy. But 45% will be shown in a year's or two time to have ADHD, autism, language disorder, etc. So children with febrile seizures should be looked at once again. If they present with febrile seizures, say at the age of two, you should look at that child again a year later, because it's very often a signal that there is something immature or you know, variant in the brain development. There's also this big group, which people don't talk about, of continuous spike wave activity during slow sleep. Nobody knows exactly how common it is in the general population, but children with autism, for instance, in several studies have been shown to have an enormously high rate of continuous spike wave activity. That's epileptogenic discharge in sleep. And it's still a matter of controversy as to what should you do about it if you find that on your EEG. And I'm not one to tell you that you have to, you know, put them on an anti-epileptic, etc. But there is a need for study and intervention studies on the group of children with autism who also have CSWS, that's continuous spike wave activity, or epileptogenic discharge during sleep. Finally, there's PANS, an even more controversial subject. Pediatric acute onset neuropsychiatric syndrome. It's like autism 40 years ago. It's like people don't believe it. No, cannot exist. I've never seen that. It's just mums, you know, talking to themselves, and they don't know what they're talking about. But we have seen, and we now have a series of about 20 cases, ages 4 to 20. That have developed all these symptoms, usually virtually everything on the list, almost overnight, from being almost, as it were, normally functioning to having the most severe neuropsychiatric disorder you can think of, with everything meeting criteria for anything on the list, plus usually also enuresis and separation anxiety. And it happens from one day to another, or at least it doesn't take more than a week for all the symptoms to develop. And it sort of comes out of the blue. Even though once you start taking a very good and detailed history, you'll find actually there will be some indications that there were some mild autistic features or some features of some of the other disorders even before the onset of this dramatic constellation of symptoms. So that's what essence is, and we could leave it at that. But the problem is, together, or the studies that have been performed have usually looked at just one of these boxes and said, followed cases up over years and said, this is the outcome. We don't really know what happens if you have everything here, but we do know that individually these syndromes actually predict academic failure. That's the top thing that they predict. More than 90%, if they are not assessed early, diagnosed, and given good support, they will fail academically. And it's a catastrophe that people don't talk about this and don't think about it as the major negative outcome, because it's clearly something we could do something about if we knew about the sort of diagnosis or problems from the very beginning. There will be other school adjustment problems, social exclusion. Unfortunately, in the big group with ADHD, there's a very high risk of early substance use and misuse. Psychiatric disorder, eating disorders, as I'll come back to, including obesity in the ADHD group in particular. Accidents, unfortunately, very common in the ADHD group, but also disappearing, which is overrepresented in autism and which also people have not wanted to, you know, even talk about. It's much more common that children actually disappear in autism than in any of the other conditions on this list. Various kinds of empathy problems, antisocial lifestyles, criminality, not in the autism group. There's no increase in criminality in the autism group, but there is a huge increase in the ADHD group. And there is a slight, not risk that among people with autism they will become mass murderers, but if you go from the other perspective and look at those mass murderers who have been in the, you know, been diagnosed as such, if you will, who have killed more than three people at a time, that there are more people diagnosed with autism in that group. But it's extremely rare, of course, and not something that you should think about as this, oh, so now because of the autism diagnosis, there's a risk that this person will become a mass murderer. But taking it from the other perspective, it's important to know that if it happens, you need to think about that possibility. Persistent autistic features in the autism group is very typical, and it's typical also of all the other groups. If once you met criteria for ADHD in early childhood, you're never going to be completely un-ADHD, if you will. You're never going to be completely unautistic in the sense that everything that sort of typified you when you were a child will be gone by the age of 35 or 40. There will always be something, as it were, left. But that's not necessarily something that you should think about as disorder, much more like variant or, you know, we're all different anyway. And I've just written on our website, if you're interested, actually, we have a lot of followers on our website. So if you go to the gnc.gu.se and follow our website, you'll learn some interesting things, I'm sure. I've just written a blog where I sort of take issue with normality. What's so good about normality? Why is normal the norm when we're all abnormal anyway? I mean, there's not a single person who can make claim to, oh, I'm absolutely normal. I'm the most normal people you've ever seen. If you're normal, you are normal in everything. And I'm sure nobody is. Nobody on the planet is absolutely normal. If you measure everything there is to measure in all of us, everyone will come out as, in that respect, this person is not quite normal, not within the normal distribution. And also, we'll all have a diagnosis at one time or another in life. Before we die, at least when we die, we have a diagnosis. So please stop talking as much about is it normal or abnormal. These are all variants of human behavior and variants of human functioning. I think it's good if people could, I mean, it's quite useful, the concept sometimes, but you have to have it at the back of your head that, well, it isn't all that fantastic to be normal. And how boring. I mean, if you have somebody who is absolutely normal in every which way, how boring would that be? Not interesting at all, at least I don't think so. Also, it's important to know that these individuals will develop physical health problems with time. And we've just completed a study in Japan looking at unmedicated young university students who have ADHD problems. And they have much higher pulse rates and a tendency to higher blood pressure. than the general population without ADHD features. And so that there's a general sort of understanding that if people with ADHD have high blood pressure or pulse rates, it's because of the medication that they're being given. But that doesn't seem to be the case at all. It's more like ADHD in itself is associated with more, you know, autonomic hyper-reactivity.